what time we are today. But this morning, God blessed us in a lovely, wonderful way. Lovely to see so many people as God filled his house here. Last night, God blessed us. Friday morning, God blessed us. And do you know what? He's going to bless us again tonight. Isn't he wonderful?
Yes.
This afternoon, we had a lovely time in Sunday school again. Sunday, and we have a great number of our Sunday school children here tonight. Isn't that great?
Yes.
So we'll be giving them Easter eggs after because they're so faithful. Israel and his brothers here and Gabriel. Every week they get them. Every week. That's right, absolutely. And their behavior is amazing. You must be so proud of our mums. They're amazing. And so we thank God for them and we pray that God will just continue to bring them to Sunday school. And I had brought hundreds of eggs tonight for all the boys and girls in Sunday school, and some of them haven't come.
Oh.
Now, I don't know whether to keep the eggs for next week or just to give it to the boys and girls of the year. Give them 10 eggs each. What do you think, Mum? Your mum said it's too much, so that's it then. You'll have them. But it's lovely to see you all. It's great to see Alan with us. Lovely that you were here with us. Lovely to see Maddie with us. I asked Maddie, I said, we got a little song taking place later. I want Maddie to tell me what she thinks of it. And because Dot missed this morning, we have to have this take place again. I'll explain later, but we've had some phone calls today, and some of them said, will you do this? And so we said, yes, we will. So it's happening again tonight. Isn't that good?
Yes.
So we're just going to thank God right now. Ask God to bless us. Ask God to move amongst us. Coyote, will you pray for us tonight, please?
Lord Jesus, thank you for this victorious Sunday, where we remember that, Lord Jesus, you are risen and risen indeed. Thank you for how you spoke to us this morning. Thank you for Sunday school. And we thank you for tonight. Lord Jesus, I pray that you just move tonight. You move through the songs, you move through the word, you move through every part of this service. And your name will be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. I want us all to sing, "You Deserve the Glory," together. It's Easter time. And all the glory must go to God and to him alone. Let's stand and sing, "You Deserve the Glory."
There is no one
believe that he does miracles?
Yes.
What a wonderful Savior, we said. We're going to be speaking about a miracle tonight. A miracle that took place on the cross of Calvary. Isn't that tremendous?
Yes.
You see, Easter weekend is filled with miracles, isn't it?
Yes.
You know, people say it was a miracle that Jesus went to the cross. It was a miracle that he rose again. Can I tell you something, friends? It was a miracle that he ever died. The everlasting one, the one who is life, how could he die? It's a miracle, we can't understand it, but we know that he did. And he died in your place, and he died in my place. I want us to read some verses from Luke chapter 23. Just a few verses. Luke chapter 23. And I want to read from verse 39 to 45. Luke chapter 23 and verse 39 to 45. Luke 23 verse 39. One of the malefactors which was hanged railed on him, saying, "If thou be Christ, save thyself and us." But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Dost not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man hath done nothing amiss." And he said unto Jesus, "Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom." And Jesus said unto him, "Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise." And it was about the sixth hour, and there was a darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour, and the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. We pray that God will add a blessing to the reading of his precious word. We're going to sing a hymn that we sang this morning, last night. We love this hymn. It speaks of the resurrection of Christ. We're going to sing "Up from the Grave He Arose." There are so many great hymns, but this hymn is something that we've got to sing at Easter time. We're going to sing it, and then we are going to have those Sunday school children that we have here at the moment. They'll come out and they'll sing with the teachers. It's a shame that we didn't have them all here. You know, when you think that our Sunday school fills all the centre now and goes on to that side and goes on to that side, if they're all here tonight, we'd have to be up in the balcony. Wouldn't that be amazing?
Yes.
We keep thanking God for these amazing children. But we're going to sing this hymn. I want us to stand together again. "Low in the grave he lay." Let's stand together.
Yeah.
be seated. Last night I asked how many people knew that hymn, and I couldn't believe that most of the congregation didn't know it. I couldn't take it in. A hymn that sings about the wonderful resurrection of our wonderful Savior. God help us to learn these hymns. God help us to sing these hymns from the very bottom of our hearts. Now, I said we are thrilled to have our Sunday school every week. It's just a small number of them today. But I'm going to ask them to come forward. We're going to sing two songs. So don't worry about that. That was Uncle Mike's fault. Yeah. So we are going to have all the children and the teachers come out, please, and stand on these steps. One step, and then we'll have the teachers on that top step. Come on, teachers, get up there, don't be nervous. Now, what you'll notice, boys, you shouldn't be sitting on the floor. Come down the front for you, for me. Right, excellent. Get up there, Leonard, come on, Uncle Coyote, get in there, we want you all in there. Come on, Auntie Lola, don't be frightened. Right, that's good. We're going to sing two Sunday school songs here. Two Sunday school. Do you know these children? Look at them, they're angels, aren't they? You mean that, yeah? None of them mess around. I've never seen them do any. Have any of you seen anyone do anything wrong ever?
No.
Never. They're just amazing. This little boy over here, he's so quiet, he doesn't move. He doesn't do anything. He's I seen him today at Sunday school. He was rolling about on top of his head. Amazing. Whenever we sing these songs, so we're going to sing two songs. What's the first one we're going to sing? Right, now I want you to concentrate. I want no messing at all. I wanted to show you mums and dads how amazing you are. Quinn, I tell you, Quinn won the prize today for the best boy in Sunday school. You stand over there, and no one can disturb you, can they? Right? You ready? Right, come on then, let's sing this first one.
People laid branches and clothes on the ground to dwell.
And I'm doing it. I'm doing it, yeah. Leave it there. They're amazing, aren't they?
Yeah.
They're amazing.
Yeah.
We're going to sing another. I wish the other 60 was here as well. We're going to sing another song. You ready for the next one? I want you to pay attention to me. My way. Thank you. Outside the city, ready? Depression on his face every time he knows you're having this quiz. But something happened today at Easter time. He won the quiz. It was amazing. He was running around. He was so he wanted to do the conga. got injured. I said, calm down. I couldn't believe it. I tell you, it was amazing, exciting. It's exciting in Sunday school. You've got to come here. That's right, isn't it, Lindsay?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes, that's right. And so we're going to have Lydia to come and sing for us now. I've asked Lydia if she'll come and sing for us. I apologise. I never told her she was singing tonight. Let's give her a song she's never sung before, sir.
Yes, Lydia. Go, girl.
Lydia, go, girl. I want to sing, Lord, I lift your name on high. I want it to be nice to me when we go home. Don't go. I tell you what we'll do then. We had something this morning. The children come and sang Sam and the Brunettes. And I had a number of phone calls saying, will you do it again tonight? Because we weren't there this morning. Okay? So I said, yeah, we'll do it again. We wanted Andy Dot to see them and hear it. Okay? So you've got to pay attention now, no more sleeping. And they're going to do it again for those that wasn't here this morning. We just got to set things up for a minute. Good job that Sam is here now.
Yes.
I am not clear what he's doing, but I trust him. Do you know he's rewired our house? We don't pay anything electric. He's taking from next door. Whenever you're ready, Sam, you know, because Christmas coming up. Remote bow. Yeah, but while they're sorting that out, we'll do something else. Sit down, let me tell you about that. We'll sort it out. I think we'll just have a few announcements. We mentioned this morning that we're praying for a number of people. There are many people that are in need, and we pray for them all. It was lovely to see Doreen here this morning. We continue to pray for those faithful people of this church, Kerry and Elizabeth. Pray for Doreen, and we pray for others that God would just be with them and bless them. There are many people in great need at this time, but we've been praying for a family that has three children, and the gentleman has cancer and has been given 6 months to live. We pray that God will heal him, because God is able, isn't he?
Yes.
God is able, and we just pray, continue to pray for them, and we just pray that God will move in our church. I want you to remember that we have another service tomorrow. Another service tomorrow, 7:30. Don't miss our final service. We are hoping that there are people coming from other churches. Do you know, there have been people said to me, we have no services to go to. We had a gentleman and his wife here on Saturday night, last night, and they said we couldn't find another church for that Easter service. Isn't that sad? In our land, thank God we are here. Come tomorrow, whatever happens. Nothing, don't let anything stop you coming, because God will bless those that come tomorrow more than those that come tonight. Who've been to all the meetings so far? Raise your hand. And look at Amanda, the way she's looking. She's smiling. She wants everyone to see her face. Do you know why she's smiling now? Because she's been to more meetings than her father. Oh. Right. Who's coming tomorrow? Tomorrow's meeting. It goes too quick, Easter. And I just pray that God will bless us in a special way. Are we ready? Yeah? Right. Okay then. You come out. Ready? I've got to do a special part in this. Okay. Now, without me, this couldn't go forward. I'm going to show you what I'm going to do. I go over to the music technical desk. I raise a finger. I wait for the command. Press a button. Amazing. I wanted to know I taught them all those moves. Isn't it wonderful to be able to sing these wonderful songs with Jesus? What a happy day. What did you think, Maddie?
It was fantastic.
Oh, sorry. for a moment there, it was wonderful. Right? You know what I mean? Fantastic. It was amazing. We just thank the children and everyone that's taking part tonight. We're just going to pray for the choir. They're going to come and sing in a moment. We've been blessed by the choir this week. You know, this morning we sang a song, and Thelma said to me, can we sing it again tonight? Because I love it. Everyone loves it. And behold his glory. And I thought to myself, no, let's make people wait for it, innit? So we're going to sing it tomorrow night. If you want to hear the most incredible song that has ever been sung, you've got to come tomorrow night. I told Alan said, I'm working. I said, give you know what to say. It doesn't matter about it, you know, money to live, don't worry about it. Can't miss this song tomorrow night. Lovely. But tonight we got two lovely songs. Two lovely songs tonight. And again, I want to thank everyone that has faithfully come to the choir practice. You know, we got young people, children, that have come every week, not missed. And I think that's incredible. And so I want you to focus. I don't want anything to distract you from what you're going to do in just a moment. But let's just pray. Then the choir will come up and minister to you in song. Loving Heavenly Father, we give you thanks again for this opportunity that is ours, Lord, to come and to minister for you, Lord. And we pray for every member of the choir, Lord, from the youngest to the oldest. Lord Jesus, we thank you for them, Lord. We thank you for their faithfulness, Lord. And we pray that you will bless them, Lord. Lord Jesus, we pray as they come now, anoint their singing, Lord. And for those that are sitting, Lord, as they hear the songs being sung, oh God, we pray, let them feel your presence in such a wonderful way. So move, we pray, and may your name be glorified. In the name of Jesus, we ask it. Amen. As they come, can we just have on there, no one like Jesus. No one like Jesus. As the choir comes up, please, and take their place. Take up your cross. And let me just say, it's lovely to see Telly and Tara's mum and dad here tonight. Yes. lovely to have you. Your children are amazing. We saw everyone in the church. We are thrilled they come in week by week. Every meeting they won't miss. Even when you try to stop them. Right now, we're going to sing, Take Up Your Cross. Take Up Your Cross.
Your cross and follow.
Up and by the end they're almost tired, and so we sing this song to wake them up a little bit. Okay, we're gonna sing "Every Praise Is to Our God."
Hallelujah.
Lord, come again. Isn't that amazing? We thank God for the choir. We thank God. Can you see those children there? Isn't it incredible?
Yeah.
Isn't it incredible? You've got to praise these children. We've got to thank God for these children. I can go through them all. And it's just a privilege in this church to have these children here. You know, these two boys here, their mum and dad is Nikki. I don't know them to miss a meeting. Isn't that incredible? Isn't that amazing? Right? I don't know who your dad is, but you're wonderful. Dunstan, right? Look at her new robe. We have to get especially made for. Isn't she amazing?
Yes.
Amazing. These two girls, they must be the quietest girls we've ever known. They don't move. They just sit. I can't understand it. I've never seen anyone move so much as Tenny. She's got so much energy, so much life. She's incredible, right? And then we've got Mena. Can I say that Mena has been in every single choir practice? Isn't that incredible? Mum and Dad didn't bring her because they couldn't be bothered, but she comes. Isn't that incredible? Right? And then there's these two on the end. What's your name? Lydia on them?
Chloe.
Chloe, Lydia. Marvellous girls. Marvellous girls. Because obviously they're my children. And we must not forget Sam on the new day. Desk. We wouldn't be able of anything because I haven't got a clue. Thank God. And then we got to thank God because we haven't got time to go through your war. I don't like you that much. We got to thank God for every person that has faithfully come and sings. And look, why don't you join? Why don't you join? I'm looking over there. I'm looking over there. I'm looking over here. Now, obviously, you've got to pass the singing test first. You come in, it takes a couple of hours, I test you out, and if you're good enough, then we'll think about it. But look what God has done in our church, and we give him all the praise and all the glory. We give them a clap as they sing. Baptismal service. So if you've never been baptized, will you please come and give me a name? Because I'd love you to join those people that are going to be baptized with new converts that want a desire to be baptized, want to follow the Lord, the way that the Word of God tells us to. Please, if you haven't been baptized, come and see me. We'll put your name down and God will bless in a wonderful way. We're going to sing a little song, Amazing Grace. Not the amazing, this is what's it called?
This is
Amazing Grace. Well, we can remain seated and we're going to take up our evening of written tithes, okay? Let's sing it together, please.
Hold us with every thunder.
turned off. You should be ready for it now after the time we've heard it. Every mobile phone can be turned off. And no movement at all, please. No movement at all while the preaching of God's word is taking place. Just remind you, please, that the service is not over until we've had the benediction, till the last prayer is prayed. Let's give God the glory and the honor and the respect and the reverence that is due unto his name. And remain in this place until we close in prayer. I want to talk to you tonight about a great miracle. A great miracle. Happened upon Calvary. I want to pray just before I do, because God is going to speak to people again tonight. Every service we've been to, God has spoke to people. God has saved people. God may save people tonight. I want you to listen to God's word. Can I ask, please, that there be no distractions? I want our young people, our children. I want all our children now, just 20 minutes. And then we'll give you your prizes, and you deserve them. But for the next 20 minutes, I want you to pay attention, to focus on what God is saying. We don't want to distract anyone from God's word. Let's pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we ask you again that you open your living word, Lord. That, Lord, you will speak, Lord. That your voice will be heard deep in our hearts and in our minds. Lord Jesus, again this night, in this congregation, Lord, we realize there are great needs. We want the people, Lord, in this place tonight to realize that we serve a great God, and there is nothing too difficult for Jesus. And so we pray, Lord, move amongst your people. We thank you, Lord, for everything that has taken place. We thank you for the Sunday school children. Oh God, we pray, bless them. What amazing young people and children, Lord. Bless them, Lord. We thank you for the choir, Lord. We give you praise for it, Lord, this night. We thank you for each one that you brought to your house. But Lord Jesus, the most important thing is that we exalt the name of Jesus. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that we will hear you speak into our hearts this night. So speak, we pray. In your name we ask it.
Amen.
Amen. I mentioned I want to speak about a great miracle that happened at Calvary. A miracle that happened at Calvary. I want to tell you, friend, about an amazing story about a man who lived all his life away from God. And in the last few minutes of that terrible sinful life, he saw a flood of spiritual vision that prepared him for eternity. In a moment of time. But today, friends, there are many who failed to see what he saw. There are many who failed to see what this man saw. He was one of the thieves who was crucified with Christ. He is known as the penitent thief. We know the story. You've read it 1,000 times. You've heard it. Jesus on the center cross. Thieves on either side. One of those thieves turned to Jesus. I want to tell you tonight, friends, whoever you are, whatever you are, whatever you've done, I thank God tonight that you can turn to him. And he wants to receive you. And he wants to move in your life. And he wants to do something wonderful in your life. The conversion of the dying thief is one of the greatest miracles of Calvary. I doubt, friends, if there's ever been another deathbed conversion like this one. This thief's deathbed was a cross. Men and women of all ages, very often on their deathbeds, will cry out some sort of confession in the hope that if there is an afterlife, that all will be well. And then people say to me, they say, Pastor, are they saved? I don't know is the answer. You see, there is only one person in the entire universe who knows if that person had cried out at the last moment is truly saved, and that person is God. You see, some will say, I'll be ready to cry out to God on my deathbed, just in case. I'll do it just in case at the last moment. And if there is anything after death, then I'm okay. Friends, don't believe it, because you cannot con God. You can con yourselves, you can con your friends, you can con your family, but you cannot con God. God knows your heart. And God knows whether it's true or not. Only one can forgive a man or a woman of this sin. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ. And so how do I know if a man or a woman is truly saved? How do I know? How do you know? By the change in their lives. By the love that they have for Jesus. By the godly lifestyle and by the faithfulness to God's work in their life and in their conversion. That's how you know, friends, if someone is truly saved. Mike, would you sort the fellow out, please? Walk him back and forth. Faithfulness to God's word in their life and conversation. That's the fruits of salvation, friends. That's the fruits of those who get right with God. And I trust that no one here tonight, friends, will delay getting right with God. No one will delay hoping to put their life right on their deathbed, because you won't have that opportunity. And so if you were here, friends, and you were concerned about eternity, why not get right with God tonight? Why not get right with God when you can? Why not get right with God when you're able to live for Him and thank Him for all that He's done? That's what the prophet Isaiah said. He says, "Seek ye the Lord while He may be found. Call ye upon Him while He is near." So just for a short time, friends, I wanted to look at this dying thief who found mercy hanging beside him. He turned his head and he looked at mercy and he found and accepted mercy in his last few minutes. The first thing he saw, friends, was that he was a sinner. That was the first thing he realized. And I want to tell you tonight, friends, that if you want to know Jesus as your true Savior and friend, you have got to realize and recognize that you are a sinner. Amen. And not just a sinner, a hell-deserving sinner. That you deserve to go to hell. And there's only one who can forgive you and give you freedom. You see, as the crowd round about the cross mocked the suffering Savior, as did his partner in crime, and he looked over and said to him, "Don't thou not fear God, seeing that thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man hath done nothing amiss." This man has done nothing amiss. What this dying thief realized, friends, was not mere academic intellectual knowledge, but he saw he was a guilty sinner, a guilty, hell-deserving sinner. He realized it. God showed it to him. And that's the basis of a man or a woman's salvation tonight. When they see and they realize that they are a guilty sinner on their way to hell. Listen, friends, to me tonight. No man, no woman can ever be saved until they realize that they're sinners. No man, no woman can ever be truly saved until they realize that there is no hope without Jesus. What Christ died for at Calvary is the heartbeat of redemption, the core of the gospel. Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 3 declared, "Christ died for our sins." That's what the dying thief saw. Christ died for our sins. Then secondly, friends, the second thing the dying thief saw was Jesus was sinless. Jesus was sinless. He saw that he was a guilty, hell-deserving sinner, but he saw that Jesus was sinless. Listen to him again, friends, as he rebukes his partner in crime in verse 41. He says, "But this man has done nothing amiss." This man has done nothing amiss. It took a sinless life and an atoning death to make a perfect and total sacrifice for sin, friends, and to satisfy the just demands of a holy God. And that's what Christ has done for you, friends, tonight. That's what Christ has done for me. He simply took your place and my place upon Calvary. And that's what the thief saw hanging beside him, a sinless, perfect sacrifice. The Lamb of God, it says, it taketh away the sin of the world. Then thirdly, friends, the third thing that I and thief saw was that he needed to repent. If you read Mark's Gospel and link it up with Luke's story, friends, you will discover in Mark chapter 15 the two thieves who were crucified with Jesus, first of all, began to revile him. Just as the crowd reviled him, these two thieves began to revile him just as well as the others. But as the minutes ticked on, and as the minutes ticked by, and as the hours passed by, he saw things and heard things so holy and so pure that he cried out for mercy. He knew there was something different about this man on the Santa Cross. And in verse 42, he cries these words, Lord, remember me. Lord, remember me. And here is the repentance, friends, from profanity to praying. If there is no true repentance, friends, there is no true salvation. If there is no repentance, there is no salvation. What is repentance? It's a total change of direction in your life. The Bible says you are made a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. It's a new lifestyle. No longer living the way you have. Now serving Christ and giving your all for Christ. That's what repentance is, friends. A new direction. God will not pronounce you innocent, friends, until you plead guilty. But the tremendous thing is, as soon as you plead guilty, as soon as you say I'm a sinner, he's prepared to pardon you and cleanse you with his precious blood. This is the God that we're speaking about tonight. Then fourthly, friends, the dying thief saw that feelings had nothing to do with it. You see, at the dying thief's conversion, there was no mention of elation or euphoria. You see, friends, you don't feel good when you're being crucified. So what was it that saved him? Some people say, oh, you know, I want to feel good. It's not about feeling good. What is it that saved this man? It was faith. Faith in a living sacrifice. Faith in God. Faith and faith alone. Faith saved him. He took the Savior at his word. And I want to tell you tonight, friends, if you want to know true salvation, you've got to take Jesus at his word. What was his word? Verse 43, it says this, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. And that's what Paul meant when he said in Ephesians, by grace ye are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. There is no one here tonight can say, I'm saved because of what I've done. No one can say it. No one in this world. You are saved because of what Christ has done. And Christ the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Do you know, friends, what happened at Calvary? The dying Christ imparted to that man saving faith. And he called upon his name and he was gloriously saved. And again, I say today, isn't Jesus wonderful? Isn't Jesus wonderful?
Yes.
What a Savior. And then fifthly, he also saw, friends, that Jesus was the Son of God. He saw that Jesus was the Son of God. In verse 42, he cried, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Do you realize, friends, that everybody standing round that cross thought this Galilean prophet had nothing? They thought he had no kingdom. He was an impostor. Soon he would be disposed of. But the thief saw him. Saw him in his suffering and in his humiliation. And he realized his suffering and his humiliation was for the glory of God. He realized that he had a kingdom. He realized that he needed to be part of that kingdom. The thief saw his glory. Have you seen, friends, the glory of God? Even you Christians tonight, have you seen the glory of God? You know, I see his glory in every Lord's Day, as we come around the table to break bread, I see His glory every Lord's Day, as we break the bread and take the juice in remembrance of Him. He was a king. He is a king. And He will always be a king.
Hallelujah.
The Bible says the King of all kings.
Yes,
and amen. The Lord of all lords.
Jesus.
He has a kingdom.
Yes.
And the thief says, I want to be in that kingdom. And as he hangs on the cross, he says, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. You have a kingdom and I want to be in it. And then sixthly and finally, the dying thief saw that he would rise from the dead. The dying thief saw that he would rise from the dead. Listen to him again. Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. He knew that he wasn't going to die and be buried and stay there and remain there. He knew that he was going to rise again and rise into the kingdom of heaven. He saw Christ. He saw Christ triumphant beyond the grave. The resurrection of Christ from the dead, friends, is the proof of Almighty God's acceptance of the blood that Christ shed for you and for me to be saved. But he also saw, friends, that he would be raised with Christ from the dead to enjoy Christ's triumph. I want to ask you tonight, what do you think of Christ? What do you think of Christ? What do you think of the blood of Jesus? The hymnist said, the dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And you ready for this? And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Tonight, friends, the blood of Jesus flows as fresh as ever.
Hallelujah.
And he wants to cleanse men and women from their sin.
Praise
he wants you to recognize that he's your Savior. He wants to see that there's a kingdom. He wants you to see that there's something after death.
Thank
he wants you,
Lord.
To see that there's a heaven to gain and there's a hell
you,
to shun. And he wants you to accept this wonderful
praise
salvation
you,
that is free for you this night. Oh, what a wonderful Savior.
Hallelujah.
The dying thief saw that he would rise from the dead. Listen to him again, friends. Lord, remember me when thou comest. He saw Christ triumph beyond his grave. You see, the resurrection of Christ from the dead is that which proves that salvation is ours.
Thank you, Jesus.
What do you think of Christ tonight? What do you think of Christ who spoke to this dying thief? What do you think of him, friends? Or you say, I'm busy, I've got things to do. I want to ask you a question. Are you going to die without Jesus?
No.
I'm not interested, Pastor. I've got so much on, so much going on in my life. Can I tell you, friends, and I tell it because it's true what I'm telling you. Jesus can take your last breath right now when you have no future.
No.
Jesus gives you the very breath for the future that you desire. I ask you again, friends, what think ye of Christ?
Amazing.
We were thrilled this week, thrilled, when we heard our daughter had spoke to John. After months and months of praying, now John said, I want to ask Jesus into my life. When I went there to visit, he said, yes, I've asked Jesus, I put things right with Jesus. Thank God, friends, that someone was prepared to put things right with Jesus. And you might be here tonight and you need to put things right with Jesus. Because you can't die without him. If you're living without him, friend, don't die without him. And do you honestly expect friends, in the last few seconds of your miserable life to cry, Lord, save me, and he'll come and save you? Or tonight I pray, friends, that you will see what this thief saw. You see, he saw the miracle of Calvary. And at a revelation of the Christ, what are you going to do in the light of eternity? Is there someone here, friends, this night who will cry from the very depths of your soul, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Remember me, make me right, God. Something else I want you to notice. Get those words in your mind tonight, friends. Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. You will know, friends, that the New Testament was taken and translated from the original Greek manuscripts to our language. And the Greek experts tell me that the sentence, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom, actually means that he kept on repeating, Lord, remember me. Lord, remember me. Lord, remember me. The desperation, friends, as he was coming to the end of his life, over and over again. You see films of the crucifixion. When you look at those films of the crucifixion, they're quiet. It wasn't quiet, friends, at Calvary. There was a multitude of things going on at the cross. People were talking, people were shouting, people were railing, people were mocking. All sorts of things were happening. But in the midst of it all, the thief kept on repeating, Lord, remember me. And he kept repeating it until Jesus replied to him. Now that's the sense, friends, that the Greek text gives. And what does this tell me? It tells me, friends, this thief was persistent. This thief had a true revelation of Christ. And with all his being was calling upon Jesus to remember him. Listen, friends, he kept pounding on the ear of the Savior. Lord, remember me. Now it would seem that Paul kept on speaking to each other. He spoke to Jesus, but Jesus spoke to him. The one penitent thief kept on begging him, save yourself. Save yourself and us. But the other thief said, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. The penitent kept on begging him to be remembered when he came into his kingdom. And he would be remembered. For back came the very words on the mouth of God, verily, verily, it means truly, truly. The Lord repeated it to him, truly, truly, I say unto you, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Where are you tonight, friends? How are you going to live the rest of your life? You see, whoever you are, whatever your age, makes no difference. The Bible states, and it's a fact of life, that death will come to us all. But the Bible says, after that, the judgment. Are you going to live, friend, the way you are and continue to do it and miss eternity with Christ? And hope for the last few moments in your life to say, oh, quickly, send for a minister, and he'll come and he'll read some lovely psalms to me, and he'll say a little prayer. But it's not the prayer of the minister, friends. But it's your cry to Jesus that saves you that counts. Do you know if you're saved tonight? Do you know if you're right with God? Do you know, friends, the only way you can get right with God is to come to him tonight and feel his presence enter into your very heart and know his joy in your heart? Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Don't leave it too late, friends. Don't reject God as he calls to you in mercy and in love tonight. Each time you reject him, you are tramping on the blood of Jesus and on the mercy and on the love of God that he has shown to you through Calvary. Call on him for mercy, friends. Call on him for salvation, because he's the King of all glory. He's the King of all glory. Call on him tonight, friends. Each one here tonight, each one of you here tonight, no one, there's not one of us better than you. It's not because we're any better. The Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory. There's no one better than anyone else in this place. But Jesus paid the price for each and every one. And for those that know Jesus, we know better. The Bible says we are sinners saved by grace. Oh, but it's lovely to be saved, isn't it?
Amen.
Are you glad you're saved, friend?
Yes.
So tonight, as we draw to a close, the message is simple. The truth is plain. If you ask Jesus to forgive your sin, he will come into your heart. He will come into your life. He will give you assurance. He will give you, take away the doubt, and he will make you ready for eternity. I want us to bow our heads and pray. Each and every one of us, I want us to look in, friends, at this Easter time. I want us to understand that God is speaking, not a man. I want you to understand this night that Jesus is speaking into your heart. And he's simply saying, are you ready to accept my salvation? He's waiting for you to call upon him and say, remember me. Remember me when thou enter into thy kingdom. Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. He's waiting, friends, to give you eternity like you've never imagined before. And so, friends, simply after this word is spoken, is there someone here tonight and you say, God has spoken to me for so long, I've put it off, I've tried not to listen, I've laughed it, I've mocked it, I've ridiculed it, but God has spoken to me and I want Jesus in my life. Is there someone here tonight, and if that's you, would you just raise your hand right now and we'll pray with you and Jesus will be your Savior and your Lord. Someone who has never asked Jesus into their heart. Is there something tonight as Jesus speaks? I need you in my life, Jesus. I need my sins forgiven. Is there one person tonight? Just as we remain in this attitude of prayer, I just want to ask tonight, is there someone here who is backslidden? Someone who is backslidden. Someone who says, I want to put my life right to Jesus. I've been cold, I've been away, but I want to come back. It's your opportunity tonight because God is waiting. It's the last time I'm going to ask you. If there's someone here, just raise your hand and we'll pray together. Loving Heavenly Father, we give you thanks this night for being in your presence. We thank give you thanks, Lord, for each one that is here this night. And we thank you, Lord, that you know each one, that you know each heart. And Lord Jesus, you have never failed anyone. You have never turned away from anyone that calls upon your name. And so we pray, Lord Jesus, for everyone that is not right with you in this place. Lord, will you keep speaking to them? Will you continue to speak to them night and day until they call upon the mighty name of Jesus? Help them to do it, Lord Jesus, before it's too late, we pray. Help each one here to live for you like never before, to love you like never before. Bless, we pray. In the name of Jesus, we ask it. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to close our service by singing a little song, and then all the children that are in Sunday school, if you can see Auntie Amy, she'll give you an egg and what have you. And if there's any children here that haven't been to Sunday school, but you're here tonight, I want you to go and see Auntie Amy as well, and she'll give you something as well. So we're going to close, and we're going to sing that song. We've got to sing it tonight. We're going to sing Thank You for the Cross. We're going to finish by singing Thank You for the Cross. When you're ready, Sam. Don't forget tomorrow, 7:30, our last service. Don't forget. Let's stand to sing together.